This is a coronavirus update for April the 1st, 2020. I'm Dr. Erik Beyer. I'm a cardiothoracic surgeon in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. The total number of cases worldwide is 877,584. Total number of deaths is 43,569. In the United States, there's been over 24,700 new cases in the past 24 hours with over 900 deaths. So we definitely lead the way in numbers. Italy has seen a decrease in their numbers recently, which is good news. I think they're getting over the top of the their curve there, which is good news. Spain is right in the middle of their worst part of their process, I believe. They've had over 7,900 new cases. And then you have China has very few cases being diagnosed, though they did have five deaths over the past 24 hours. And there's Germany with a number of cases, France, and they're all heading into the top of the curve, as well as you can see on this chart. In the United States, we've had 188,647 cases with 4,059 deaths. New York, again, leads the way. They've had over 8,600 new cases in the past 24 hours with over 370 deaths in the past 24 hours. Then there's New Jersey, California, Michigan, and Florida. Massachusetts is right behind, and Illinois is making their way up the list as well. So things to be aware of. Washington State seems to be slowing down a little bit, which is good news. In Florida, they've had a total of 6,741 cases and 85 deaths. So you can see Broward County has a total of 1,219 cases with 12 deaths. So we've registered another death over the past 24 hours. And then Dade County has the most cases in the state with 2,123, and they had their seventh death in the past 24 hours, so they had an extra death, one death in the past 24 hours. There was in the news today the second coronavirus death reported of a person who attended the Miami Beach Winter Party, which is this annual party, and several of the party attendees have reported suffering from flu-like symptoms. The individual that was reported deceased is Ron Rich, and there's a picture of him on the Facebook page for the National LGBTQ Task Force, and they're mourning his loss. Yesterday, during the White House press conference, you can see this curve was presented, which is pretty dramatic. The blue curve, which is heading straight up, is New York, and the next one behind it that's heading straight up is New Jersey. And then you can see the rest are all kind of, I don't know if they're on their way up or falling flat. We'll have to see. But these are interesting charts. This was based on a model by Chris Murray. It's the IHME graph. And you can see that we're about 14 days until peak count of daily deaths for the United States. And they're projecting between 100 and 200 and 1,000 people passing away from this on these projections. I'm sorry, Christopher Murray is the professor and chair, Department of Health Metric Sciences. He is the founder of the Global Burden of Diseases. I looked this up because this is where the White House is getting their numbers. And they have charts on each individual state. This is Florida's chart, and I looked at it, and I could see that on May the 2nd or 3rd is when the peak resources will be used, which is 31 days. That's what he's projecting. And then he's also projecting the maximum number of deaths is around May the 3rd or 4th on his model. Hopefully this won't be the case. I'm not the expert here clearly, but I'm hopeful this will flatten out much more than he's describing. But you can see the deaths per day on that date would be approximating between 179, but could range between 49 and 468 per day. This is New York. Their peak resource date use is April the 9th, and they also have a peak death day of about on April 11th. And you can see their number of deaths per day is much higher, projected at 841, and could be as up to 1,100 a day around that time frame. So we'll see if those hold true. I did look around. There was an interesting article in the New Yorker. If you have time, you should read it. It's this article. It was written by the person that you see there. And it says, "How does the coronavirus behave inside a patient?" I think it's a fascinating article. I think it's very readable to the layperson and will help give you some insight into this virus. One other issue that I wanted to talk about was having a strategic reserve of these PPEs and masks and antivirals, which we clearly didn't have enough of. And the United States takes pride in itself having a strategic petroleum reserve, which is a very huge reserve of oil that is located in these salt caverns. They were artificial caverns created by salt domes. And these are huge caverns that hold a massive amount of oil. And then they're located on the Gulf Coast, and they're near refineries, so that in case we ever have problems getting oil, we can actually produce them. Also, we spend an enormous amount of money on the Utah Data Center, which is the Intelligence Community Comprehensive National Cybersecurity Initiative Data Center. And we spend a lot of money on this, rightfully so. I think it's important. But I think it's very important that we spend a significant amount on, and I don't think it's going to take that much to have the appropriate number of PPEs and antivirals and antimicrobials, in a stockpile in the United States. So in case we ever have another pandemic, that we can be prepared for this. And, there's been historical perspectives to this, but we clearly were not prepared. We had, not very many, masks to supply this situation, which is a real problem for our healthcare workers, who I am concerned about. And if you look at anybody else, they're also concerned about this. So something to be aware of. Also, I want to talk a little bit about interferon. There's been a lot of talk about interferon nasal applications to prevent the spread of this virus as a prophylactic and as a treatment. In the webinar I did or was a part of on Saturday, here's what the surgeons had to say from China about using interferon nasally.
Do you recommend interferon nasal spray as prophylactic?
Yeah, we use that for the prevention of the infection. And for those mild patients, to prevent that get into severe.
Are you using it yourself?
Good question.
但是你们我们用了吗？我们有一部分医护人员
Some of our staff, yes.
How do you decide which staff should then use the intranasal interferon spray?
Actually, we gave the medicine to the staff who will get contact to the patients directly and for prevention. But also they can use that at their own will.
So this may be something to be used in conjunction with some of the other medications, including the hydroxychloroquine and the zinc along with the Z-Pak. Those things may be used in conjunction with all of these things. But I think getting more information out there is going to be important, and finding out what regimens are going to work is super important to prevent deaths. All right, everybody, get out there and take a walk in the sunshine. Enjoy time with your family. Remember, social distancing, super important. If you don't need to get out, don't get out. And I would recommend wearing a mask. The CDC is reviewing that today. That was part of my my talk yesterday. So keep moving forward. Be conscientious, and we'll get through this together.